Good evening, everybody. I'd like to welcome you to this inaugural lecture by Eric Kerrigan. As you know, we like to show off our new professors, and in particular in congratulating them and in revealing to you what sort of person they are. Eric has had a good record in Imperial, and we're very proud of him as being a new professor. So I'll ask him straight away to give his talk, which is called, if I can find it, Eric, what's it called? Making decisions for paradigm. Oh, there it is. Thank you, Eric.
Okay. Good, thanks. Okay. Right, okay. Thank you, everybody, for coming. I've got friends here from sort of both sides of this campus. I'm actually a joint appointment in the Department of Electrical and Electronic Engineering, as well as the Department of Aeronautics. And so you'll sort of hopefully find out a little bit over the next few minutes how this sort of works, and maybe also how it sort of came about. So it's really nice to see everybody here together. So the title of my talk is Making Decisions with Known Unknowns, and hopefully by the end of it, you'll hopefully know what a known unknown is, or have a vague feeling for what it is, and why we need to work carefully with that. Right. Okay, so I think, so the first, before we start off, I would like you all to sort of just think a little bit about why do we measure anything? Why do you measure length, time, fluids, flows in your cars, or mass on the apple over there? What is the only reason, as far as I'm concerned, right? Maybe there are other reasons, but from my point of view, what's the only reason why we measure something? Right? Oh, we got an answer, right? Yeah. Sorry, you want to?
We measure things so we can compare with other things.
Compare, because you want to compare, right? Okay, from one thing to the other thing. Eric? Another Eric. You need to be called Eric if you want to be employed in this department. Yes, Eric, yes.
To make a decision.
To make a decision, right, okay.
I'm weighing too much.
Lucian, you're not allowed. You're my PhD student, my sister. Talita. To know what it is, okay, yeah.
Change.
To change things.
To make predictions.
To make predictions.
To make sure it fits.
To make sure it fits, okay. Yeah, certainly a lot of reasons, okay.
To provide accuracy on our decisions.
To provide
accuracy
on our decisions, okay. I that's sort of getting quite warm, I guess, right, to where I'm wanting to be. For me, it's to reduce uncertainty, because we don't know what that mass is or that length is, and that's the only reason we measure it. If we knew what it was, we wouldn't need to measure it, right? So it reduces uncertainty. Measurement reduces uncertainty. We get information, and it reduces all, and yeah, then you can use it to make decisions. You can use it to compare things against things. So it's a really powerful thing to be able to measure something. And this is at the core of what I do, right? Why do we measure, right? It's really about uncertainty and doing something with that measurement and recognizing that fact. Okay, so I mean, we're constantly having to make decisions in an uncertain world. So a few, this is actually taken a few years ago, this one, but this is a map of London at some point in time in the day, and you can see it's mostly red on the traffic, meaning it's mostly congested, right? Roughly, to get to Imperial from home to work, what would be the best way if I wanted to drive, right? That's a big question we go, right? What is the shortest way of doing it? Will the traffic change maybe once I'm out there? You know, maybe the optimal route when I set out is not going to be the optimal route 5 minutes, right? Because there'll suddenly maybe be another choke point, or another choke point had opened up. So how do I make the decision, you know, where I should be going and driving my car? So there's some uncertainty there. And up here, I've got the little dice with the question marks on it, and you've got to keep your eye out for all the little dice and the question marks and all the slides, right? Those are going to be my unknowns and my known unknowns, right? I'm going to be putting out there. We may be taking a whole bunch of things into account, like time, you know, to get to A to B, arrive to this talk on time. Energy use, maybe you've only got so much fuel or charge in your electric vehicle, you don't want to run out, right? You probably also want to take account of all the idling time, the air conditioning time, all that is going to be draining your energy, and you want to minimize money, obviously. You don't want to spend an exorbitant amount of doing this. So we have to make these decisions all the time, and humans are pretty good most of the time, we think. But also, how do we make machines make these decisions, right, in the best possible way? If we want to automate driving, for example, right, how do we what type of information do we provide to cars, and how do they make those decisions, right? So a lot of my research is about how do we make machines make these kind of decisions in a known, with known unknowns, right, on time and budget, and very importantly, safely as well. Right, you don't kill yourself, you don't break anything. How do we do that? Right. Okay, so hopefully by the end of this talk, you'll know a little bit more maybe about how we do that. And for those of you who've come here and expecting the BBC, I'm unfortunately not the BBC. I can't promise to inform, educate, and entertain. I will try my best to do at least one, right? Of those three, but I will start off with giving a bit of an outline of the kind of real-world challenges and problems that I've been working on over the last 16, 17 years now that I've been at Imperial, just sort of giving a high-level picture of the variety and the flavor of the kind of things that I work on, and then we'll go into a little bit about what is control, right? So I'm a professor of control and optimization, and probably some of you will never have heard the word control, and you want to know, well, what is control? So we'll spend a little bit of time talking about control. I'm a professor of control and optimization, and some of you may know what optimization is, and some of you may not, so we're going to talk a little bit about optimization. Then I'm going to put the two together over there in the bottom right-hand side. That is how I put control and optimization together to help us to make decisions with known unknowns, and then some at the end, you want some results, right? You want some numbers, you want some graphs, you want some figures. Give me, you know, what can we do now that we couldn't do 10 years ago by putting control and optimization together. Right, so hopefully you'll be informed, maybe educated, but I can't promise being entertaining. Right, okay, so I'm in the aeronautics department, and I knew nothing about aeronautics before I arrived at Imperial. They took a really big gamble. They gave me a job offer. I can either stay 100% electrical, electronic engineering, or I can take up a position where I'm 50% in aeronautics and 50% in electrical engineering. I always wanted to go into space in some form or the other, so I thought this will be a good time for me to learn how to do that, and they bravely went, okay, we'll teach you, right? You know, we'll work together with you to figure out how to do that. So a lot of my motivation behind the mathematics and the theory I do arises from a range of applications in aerodynamics, or more generally, really fluid dynamics. So when I first arrived, I worked with Mike Graham, in particular, on reducing vibrations in wind turbine blades. So as you can see, these wind turbine blades are very big, and they are constantly subjected to turbulence, and they start shaking, and they might break. And that is actually one of the big limiting factors behind how big they are. So you need to make them nice and lightweight. So what Mike proposed was to put tiny little flaps at the back of these wind turbine blades in the same way that you would have on an aeroplane, and these would actively respond to any wind gusts, stiffen up artificially, sort of stiffen up the thing, so you could actually make it a lot lighter, so it's actually without the control, it would be flapping around, but with a control, it would be nice and rigid, so you can make it a lot lighter, save a huge amount of money, both in terms of building and potentially maintenance costs in terms of it breaking. So started off with that with Mike. We did some experiments in the wind tunnel, and I continued with that also with Rafa Palacios. Another big thing that we did was, if I can just sort of start the video, I think. Can I start it on that one? No. I know this isn't my computer, right? But can you maybe start the video in the middle? Is that possible for you to do that? Right. Yeah, there we go. Oh, no. Okay, right, that's fine. Right, so one of the big things that I've been working on since then as well is Jonathan Morrison was very happy to involve me in his project, which is to reduce skin friction drag over an aerofoil. So here we have a computer simulation of flow over an aerofoil, and you can see that initially it's nice and laminar and smooth, and then it transitions into sort of turbulent flow. So what we want to do is we want to keep the laminar flow for as long as possible and prevent it from breaking down into turbulent flow. And so the idea is that you change the surface roughness, or you blow and suck a little bit of air at the surface of the aerofoil, and this reduces skin friction drag. So we've done lots of work on that in simulations and experiments in the wind tunnel. So what is our known unknown here? The unknown here is the wind gusts coming in. The known unknown over there is, again, we don't know what the airflow will look like as it comes in over the aerofoil. Over here on the bottom left, I'm keeping in the aero regime. This is classical, good old classic mechanical airplane, where again, maybe you want to land, but you don't want to crash. And again, you've got wind gusts coming along, potentially forcing you into the air, and you want to make a quick, safe maneuver coming away. More recently, I'm working with George Regas on reducing air drag behind things like trucks. So a completely different mechanism there. You've got airflow coming in over there, and there's a big sort of vortex shedding happening at the back, which changes the pressure at the back. And what we want to do is put airplane flaps at the back of a truck, and this changes and manipulates the flow behind the truck, resulting in actually a reduction of drag. So again, there what we've got is the uncertainty in the direction of the wind, which is going to come in and going over our flow. Staying in aerospace again, here we've got a rocket going up. There's lots of problems to do with rockets. The one that we quite like to work on is the so-called Goddard rocket problem, which is how do you get to the maximum altitude with minimum fuel? And it's actually a non-trivial problem, and old algorithms really struggle computing that solution, and there's also the problem of if you're coming in. So the question is, what do you do with the atmosphere and you don't quite know what your burn rate would be, so you may need to change what you did when you started off. For a few years, I spent quite a bit of time also on wave energy, so you've got a little buoy bobbing up and down. As it goes up and down, you can actually drive a motor, extract energy, but you don't quite know what the type of incoming waves are going to be, and so you need to match the resonance of your device with the incoming waves. So we worked on that for a few years. Another sort of other area, which is now I'm also an electronic engineer, that I was interested in doing is in modern data centers and modern processors, you've got choices over which processor or core or rack of computers you want to send your computation to significantly speed up computations or reduce the amount of energy that it uses. And so what you don't necessarily know is what the nature of the incoming task is going to be and what other duties and tasks that processor will be doing at that time. A big thing that we've been using actually together with George here is using our own kind of processes, designing our own processes to do control computations as quickly as possible. And I'll outline a little bit of a result there. And with Dennis Gundus in electrical engineering, who's a communications person, we've been looking at if you've got aerial networks, so robots flying around who need to communicate and coordinate with each other, who talks to who and how much data do you send across this network? It's constantly changing. You don't know what the environment's going to look like, whether there's going to be reflections of buildings. It's constantly changing. It's an unknown environment over there as well. And more recently, I've been working on a big project on energy systems. So if you've got buildings where you've got renewable energy being generated on board, but you don't know what, say, the amount of incoming sunlight is going to be, what the temperature is going to be, what the prices of the energy is going to be, how best do I store the energy, when do I turn my heating on, when do I turn my heating off, do I communicate with any other buildings and share energy usage in that way. Again, being an electrical engineer and in the electrical engineering department, I've been working with Adria on power electronics, where you want to, say, convert a DC current to an AC current in these big high voltage generators. You don't know exactly what the load's going to be, and so you want to make sure you get a nice clean signal when you translate from one to the other. So all of these are very different applications. That's why people will go, but Eric, what do you do, right? Okay. All of these things you can abstract into the same set of mathematics. Fundamentally, that's what it boils down to, is there's the same set of mathematics that I can bring all these tools towards. Okay, so I've been having fun, right? And so what is this control thing you're talking about, and why is it there? So for me, and for, I think, a lot of control people, control is feedback. Okay, so what do I mean with that, right? So if you've got an airplane there, you've got some inputs that you can give to the signals that you can give to the airplane, the amount of fuel, the aileron angle, the elevator angle, you can specify that. You can control it. You can manipulate that. You've got authority over that, but there's also some unknown inputs. That's the wind gusts coming in to your aeroplane, for example. Now you can probably measure some of those variables, so you can reduce your uncertainty. You can measure speed, air pressure, you can measure acceleration, you can measure the angle, the pitch, the orientation of the aircraft, all of that, and you can feed that into a computer. Right, so I take this, I feed it into a computer. So everything inside this little dashed line, that is the controller. And inside the controller, I have a little mathematical model of my airplane. Right, so I have an algorithm which puts in the same signals that I put into the airplane as into this little model. I simulate this model, and I look and I predict what my simulation said I would get out. So what would my airplane have done according to my model, and then I compare it against the measurements. So I estimate what these measurements are, and I compare what I measured against what I actually knew. And if there was no difference, then everything is good. But in practice, of course, there are differences. And if there are differences, then I update my model somehow, right? And it obviously depends on the nature of the model and the problem as to exactly how I do that. But you see, I have a feedback loop going around this way, okay? So that is a control loop, a feedback loop. So whenever you see that, you can draw the line, you know you're in the world of control engineering, right? And there's a whole bunch of mathematical tools which have been developed over many decades that can at least allow you to get some handle on this kind of problem. So that, there has to be equations, unfortunately. But hopefully this can be done by every first year at Imperial. Let's imagine that I'm going to use a very simple mathematical model of my actual system. So let's imagine it's like a car, and I want to have the car driving from left to right, and I want to keep it on a road, right? But I might have wind gusts or disturbances inside the road. So the x here is the position along time as I move towards the right. The W there, these are the perturbations, the wind gusts acting on it. So if I take my hand off of the steering wheel, you can work out that I'm going to be anywhere between these two red lines, right? So potentially the wind could drive me all the way to the right, or it could potentially drive me all the way to the left, right? Under the assumption that the wind is going to be in a given magnitude. Now, what I can do is I can measure what I'm doing. Now, I might also introduce some measurement noise, right? Or I can't measure anything accurately. You can measure maybe temperature to 0.1 degrees Celsius, or you know, your speed to so many 0.1 meters per second, but not an infinite amount. So there is a small amount of error, and I model that way. And then I feed it through into some function, f. And if I just choose this f to be 0, So if there's zero there, then I'm not putting anything in. So that's the open loop situation. My hands off, right? So F equals zero is hands off. But if I choose a small amount and I go in the opposite direction, so you can sort of think that if I'm moving in this direction and I push myself in this direction, so I steer in the opposite direction, then I will be moving closer towards my center line, right? So the goal here is for me to be as close as possible to my center line. If I just plug this equation in and I just iterate on this, you can go put this in an Excel spreadsheet or just do it by hand, you can work out that actually the possible spread of trajectories you get is going to be contained inside this blue line there. So you significantly reduce the behavior or possible set of behaviors of your vehicle by having this feedback in there. So this is what feedback allows us to do by this very act of measuring and then acting and making decisions on this, we can actually change the behavior of our original system just with a few lines of code, right? Okay, and that's one of the reasons I did it, because I thought that was pretty amazing, that I can just, one line of code completely change the behavior of, say, a robot or a car or an airplane, okay? So hopefully, you know, this is sufficient, right, to convince you that maybe there is something in feedback, but in reality, of course, your equations aren't this simple, and you need a lot more mathematics to deal with that. Okay, so usually at this point in time, most people, they might get it, and they go, okay, that's great, yeah, but I thought feedback is needed for everything, right? Isn't it, right? And then my answer is, yeah, probably, right? Okay, that's also why I'm interested in doing it, right? Really, there's a lot of systems out there. You can, by understanding it properly and thinking it within this context, I could potentially do something interesting and do something useful with my short life, right? Another one, of course, in the last 5 years that has come up is people go, well, I've heard of machine learning. Everyone's doing machine learning, so how does this relate to machine learning, right? And so for homework, you can go and work out the answer. But my hint to you is, can you learn without feedback? Is it possible for you to not have feedback, right? So if in your algorithm you are doing some kind of feedback, you're doing control. So can you not do that? Can you not act? It's a measurement, compare, and then act on that, right? So if you're not doing that, you probably don't have feedback. If you're doing that, you have feedback and you're in the world of control, and there might be some mathematics for you to use, and vice versa, right? Okay, so that's control, but what is optimization, right? Okay, and why with a Z? Because I'm in Britain, right? It's optimization, right? Yeah. But okay, the real reason why I do with a Z is most people don't spell it with an S, right? The Mathematical Optimization Society spells it with a Z. So I've decided to go on with the rest of the world and not confuse the rest of the world at the expense of some British people, unfortunately. Okay. So why do I think optimization is such a powerful tool? And it's because it allows me to deal with design specifications directly, right? Okay. So when students come to me with a problem, they're stuck on something. Those of you who've come to my aeronautics office, often you'll know that at some point in time, I will have pointed you to this notice on my wall, which I've stuck up there. This is often I find the root of the most design or engineering problems is because they don't have design specifications. You need to think about your specifications. If you don't have specifications, you come up, it's neither right or wrong. It's only surprising. It's nice. It's cute. Right? But how do we know whether it's right or wrong, right? So a typical design specification, when you go talk to an engineer in industry, they'll say something along the lines of boffins. I want you to come up with some design and some parameters that are going to satisfy some physical constraints, and here they are, some safety constraints, some legislative constraints, some performance constraints, budget constraints, energy constraints, time constraints. I don't normally do slides like this, but constraints, 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 right? So they specify things in terms of constraints. Okay, what do they mean? It's saying something like a number like X needs to be between some upper and lower bound. It shouldn't be more than 2 kilos, but it should be less than 3 kilos, right? I should want to keep the temperature in this room between 19 degrees Celsius and 21 degrees Celsius, right? Something like that. I want the emissions from my vehicle to be less than this. I want the electromagnetic noise from my device to be less than this, or I won't be able to put it on the market, right? And I don't want to kill anyone, right, in the process as well. Only if you've satisfied these constraints, then I want you to minimize something. Minimize the time, the energy, the cost, whatever it is. If you cannot satisfy these constraints, go home, right? Contract is null and void, or we need to negotiate, right? And why do they do it in this way? It's because if you specify constraints, it's easy to check, right? It's very quick, yep, tick, done, right? It's very difficult to check whether I have indeed found the best solution, the most optimal solution. So these constraints, which people often write mathematically in this form, this is actually the number one priority, right? It's written down below, right? Is often how we see it mathematically. But in the engineer's head, it's actually the most important thing. If I minimize this cost function, but I violate the constraints, I don't care. I can't sell that product, right? I kill people, right? So you've really got to think about the constraints, first of all. So optimization allows you to deal with these constraints in a straightforward manner. The emphasis is often wrong when people learn about it, right, I think. And that's why I would like to emphasize the constraints is what's really important here. Okay, so let's have a look at optimization. So optimization often means you want to find the lowest value of some function, right? So let's say I have this quadratic function over here, and I want to find the lowest point. So these are the level curves. And in the center there, you've got the unconstrained minimum, right? So no constraints, that's the best possible solution. But if I want to satisfy some constraint, which says I need to lie on this line over there, that's my little circle over there. That's where I really want to be. It's not the same as that point, right? And I want to do that. And so this is, I don't know where that point is before I you know. You and I can look at that with our eyes, but a real computer with X, the number of decision variables being a million, won't know where the optimum is, right? So they've got to find that optimum in the best possible time. So here we have my dad, right? And he wants to go downhill, right? Trying to beat me, right? He wants to get there faster than me, but he knows that he wants to stay upright. He doesn't want to kill himself, break any bones before he gets to the bottom. So he's got some real constraints. You can also just stay on that narrow little lane going down. And on a foggy day, we normally go sledging on a foggy day, so at least it's reasonably visible here. But on a foggy day, you don't know where downhill is, right? Or where the best place is. All you know is what's right around here, right? And often, sometimes you can't even see which way is downhill, right? When you're trying to figure this out, you do this. So my dad is the optimizer. My dad is sitting there and he's trying to figure out, okay, which way is downhill, right? While still staying on the track. Right? Again, so that's what you're trying to do when you solve a constrained optimization problem, is find the lowest path, but staying on the ski slope, right? Okay. Now, it turns out that actually, if you want to find a point that constraints are satisfied, you can turn it into an equivalent optimization problem, which is to minimize the constraint violations. Right? So if my violations of the constraints are satisfied, my cost function is zero. If I violate my constraints, my constraint violation is non-zero. So I want to go where the constraints are violated the least. So you can turn a problem of finding constraints into an optimization problem. Then if I have a problem where I want to minimize some function subject to constraints, you can convert it into this problem, which says minimize the constraint violations, and then minimize the function while satisfying these constraints. So this is one way of thinking about it, and this is one way of solving the problem. Of course, in practice, they don't do that. They solve a sequence of unconstrained problems that, in the limit, satisfies these constraints. But what they're trying to do is balance how much you're violating the constraints versus how much you are minimizing your cost function, and then they ramp up the importance of those constraints towards the end, basically. So that by the end, you're guaranteed your constraints are satisfied. So that's why we do constrained optimization. It's optimization to satisfy constraints which come from engineering design specifications. Right? For me, it's a handy tool to directly do that. These functions are incredibly complicated, so you need efficient ways of handling that. Right? So anyone who's done a module or course in optimization, they find their whole world has changed, the way they think about problems. So clearly, those of you who have already encountered, but everyone should be doing that, right? Yeah, okay, fine. Everyone should be doing control as well, right? So, but why am I a professor of control and optimization, right? These two seem like different things, right? Okay, so this is sort of the big picture of my research. What I have inside here is some wind turbines, right? And there's some wind gusts, so there's my little known unknown acting on that, and I have some measurements of, say, the amount of bending or the amount of energy that I'm generating from this. Inside here, I'll have a computer, and this computer is solving an optimization problem at every millisecond or every microsecond, however fast you need it to do that. It's solving this problem where I want to minimize some energy subject to some design specifications, right? Make sure that the energy generated by this wind turbine is as much as possible, but don't break the wind turbine, right? Okay. And you also maybe know that you can only make changes so fast or so slow, right? So that's what the computer's doing. So my research is about how to make this as fast as possible and as reliable as possible if you need to do it at the millisecond or however fast you need to do this. On the other side, there's a much larger optimization problem. So here we have an engineer sitting inside their office, and they want to design this system. You actually have a choice. Together, these two form one system. So you can either choose the length and the mass of the wind turbine blade. As I said with Mike, the reason we did wanted to do control was once we put control in place, we can build a much lighter wind turbine, which will be much more flexible that if we don't have the control, it'll break. But with the control, everything should be fine. So you can fundamentally change what you achieve there. If you knew, you can have some very smart control over there. This in itself is an optimization problem as well. The engineer would be mathematically maybe be able to write down what these constraints are that they want to satisfy. It also actually turns out sometimes you can write down analytic expressions for these, but sometimes you cannot. Sometimes these are the output of high fidelity computer numerical simulations or just some experiments, and you need to solve this problem. So there's some challenges that arise there as well in the nature of this offline design process. Okay, so you want to do both of those. So I'm interested in how to use optimization to do both the online optimization as well as the design phase where I'm designing both the system and the computer controller at the same time. Okay, so how do we do that? I've brushed over, it looked, those optimization problems looked like quite benign, but if I zoom in on them, they have this kind of nature here. This is actually a differential equation, so this D here is a derivative. So my physics goes into there, my ordinary differential equation, my differential algebraic equation, my partial differential equation, that goes in there, and maybe my other constraints go in there. The problem is this is an infinite dimensional optimization problem, meaning there is no computer in the world that can solve this problem. I can only solve it approximately. I'm trying to find functions of time, x or z, u and z, that will satisfy this, right? And there's an infinite number of constraints, potentially. I want to satisfy these constraints for all time in some time window. So how do I do that? So on a computer, I have to make an approximation. I have to chop it up. So I'm going to approximate this with, say, piecewise linear functions. Say I'm going to solve with a piecewise linear approximation. You plug it in there. There will be an error, right? And then you go, okay, I don't like the error. Let me increase and chop it up even finer. So I have a finer piecewise linear discretization. I give it to the computer. It crunches away, boop, comes up with a smaller error. Okay, so that's how most methods work. They solve this sequence of approximate problems, and they make them better and better and better at each iteration looking at the error. The problem is that most of them only do this after they've done the solution, right? So you do a lot of computation, come back, you go, I don't like that. Off you go again, don't like it. Off you go again, don't like that. So one of our big aha moments over the last few years was to say, actually, when I want to solve this approximate optimization problem, I want to ensure that my error in my constraints, particularly the differential algebraic equation over there, is less than some threshold beforehand, so that when I give it to the solver, it comes back with a solution that I want, right? And that you can actually therefore know where your source of error is, your unknown. Here our unknown is what the mismatch is between our model and the computation model, right? The real model versus the computational model. So if you want to go read about that, Yuanbo's papers, there's a preprint of that, of this idea. But roughly the thing is, as I said, you want to do that. So what we can do is you sort of say, I'm going to integrate this residual numerically, very, very finely, my error and my differential equation, and I'm going to add that into the constraint over there. And so our methods are, there's two of these methods, DAR, and, or DARE as we call it, and PBF. They'll give you these two solutions. So you say, I want this as an acceptable error level, and then you maybe have a solution over there. Most people will know about direct collocation. This is one of the most popular classes of methods. Runge-Kutta methods you may have heard of. They don't do this. They just, you end up somewhere, right? You don't know until you've solved it where you are, and then you adapt and you solve again. So we can go straight to where we need to do that. So with a Goddard rocket problem, if you want to go maximum altitude with minimum fuel, the solution isn't just to turn off all the energy, boom, and then go, right? You actually need to at some point turn it off or go somewhere in between, do a nice thing, and then you switch off your thrust. It turns out this is a really challenging problem for computers to solve. So if you give it to most solvers, they'll just give you this rubbish in between. But our solver gives you a nice little, the blue line if you allow for continuous solutions, and the black line if you want discontinuous solutions, which is what the true solution looks like. Right, so the other big challenge that we've really been looking at is how to do this really, really fast in computers. And there's a class of processors called FPGAs, or field programmable gate arrays, where you've got a bunch of memory, you've got some multipliers, some adders, some arithmetic units, and you can combine them in any way you want to do that, right? So if you can play with any number representation, any computer architecture, what is the best algorithm to solve that problem? So with George, pretty much since one of the first months that I arrived at Imperial, we've been looking at this, and this is sort of a selection of different solutions. So why does it pay to do this? So inside these optimization algorithms, you may want to solve a set of equations, and you need to do this in a very high precision if you want it to work in practice. So we said, okay, let's go really stupidly fixed point arithmetic, where we don't have any flexibility about working with really large and really small numbers. How best do we do that? And so there's a little trick you can do, which is to normalize the matrix rows, and then you can guarantee no overflow, which you can't guarantee if you don't do our little trick. So if you were to compare what would happen if you use, say, floating point arithmetic compared to fixed point arithmetic using roughly the same number of bits, down here to the left is better. Right, okay, much faster, lot faster into, you know, 5, 4, 6, 7, 10, 20, however many times, however you want to read it down there. This is the amount of resources, or for a given amount of time, the amount of chip that you need, the size of the chip that you need. So the smaller, the better, or the more parallelization you can also add to that. So you can go really, really down here. If you compare our solution against the GPU at the time, the state-of-the-art GPU, in terms of energy efficiency per computation, you were about 18, 20 times more efficient at coming up with the same result. Okay? Now, this brings me to sort of the topic of my PhD. Okay? Last little thing, all the way from when I started my PhD, what I was really interested in is if I have a physical system and I have a model of my uncertainty, what is the best way in which I should compute this strategy, right? So if I know exactly what's going to happen here, and I have very complicated dynamics in there, how do I design this thing? This problem is even more complicated. It's an infinite dimensional optimization problem. You've got to optimize functions of times. This thing here is a vector in times. This is a function of functions. You have to optimize functions of functions. So again, it's just stupid. Why would you do that, right? So we've certainly been, I've been doing that since my PhD, right? And these are a whole bunch of solution approaches that we've done. But what I want to tell you now, after doing all of that, I think this might be the most promising approach, right? The most promising approach is really quite straightforward, is to, again, solve a sequence of these problems. So what you do is you assume some uncertainty scenarios. You just say, randomly, I think these are likely, right? You solve an optimization problem where you consider those likely ones. Then what you do is you then solve another set of optimization problems where you try and find uncertainties which are going to violate your design specification. Right? And then if you find them, you add them to your sort of bank of uncertainties. And you keep iterating this process until you no longer add any more uncertainties or your cost function or solution doesn't change in much anymore. It turns out that is pretty efficient. If you were to look at the temperature control in a building where you don't know what the energy prices are going to be, the temperature is going to be, you've got uncertainty in your model, your coefficients for the wall heating coefficients are wrong. How do we do that? You can either do Monte Carlo, take like hundreds and hundreds of these, plug them in, computer will just go, sorry, can't do this, right? Our method is able to find, like with, say, maybe only about 100 scenarios pretty quickly on a normal laptop computer, say, this is all you need, and then you can simulate and test it with a much larger set of uncertainties, and it's robust to all of those. Whereas if you included the, 100, 200, 600 of these arbitrarily selected ones beforehand, once you close the loop, you can still find uncertainties which are going to violate your results, right? So pretty quickly and easily you can converge on a solution which works very well. So this brings me to the end, right? So hopefully you now know control is feedback, and the reason we use feedback is to mitigate the effect of uncertainty. Optimization, if you've got design specifications in terms of constraints, optimization is the tool to solve these classes of problems. If you have both uncertainty and design specifications, you can put the two together to give you a control, optimal controlled problem. And you've got to think about your uncertainty, where it comes from, because if you don't know what you don't know, there is no problem. You've got to have some starting point. And so that's the key thing when I start with a new collaboration is, what do we not know, right? What is it that we want to hedge our bets against? Okay, so that's hopefully what you'll take home. But this brings me to the real reason, of course, why we're here today, is for me to say thank you to a whole bunch of people. Of course, my parents over there, my dad for fostering an interest in science and engineering to me at an early age, and my mother as well for driving me to all the various activities and chess and whatever I needed to be driven to. My sister, right, who's the other Dr. Kerrigan, who could probably also be a Bake Off entrant. I don't have the picture here of her having done, but she does do amazing bakes. And my wife, of course, Jude, who's an amazing plastic surgeon, and has to juggle quite a bit of professional life as well, and supported me through this, yeah. Okay. So, and also to three people who were quite key early on in my career, Jan, Thank you very much for taking me on board as your PhD student, right, in Cambridge all that years ago, jumping in. David, who I met sort of towards the end of my PhD, while I stayed in Cambridge, we collaborated via fax in those days, right? That was really how we did things. And of course, this was my first introduction to Imperial, and I sort of came down to Imperial on quite a regular basis to chat with David and his students at the time. Manfred, who allowed me some visits during my PhD period at ETH, which was really nice to meet other people who also thought like me and introduced me to a whole bunch of concepts and ways of thinking and kept supporting me as well during my postdoc. And ETH is almost like a second home for me. And of course, coming here, Imperial, George, from the very beginning, we've had one of the most productive collaborations that I've ever had, and I hope this will continue pretty much for as long as we could. Jonathan, Mike, and Christos, for being those first three aeronauts who went, okay, you know nothing, right? But happy to learn from each other, you know, and I thought that was really amazing that they had such big faith. And it's completely changed the way I think about control, about engineering, about science. If I had not been in the aeronautics department, I would not be thinking the way that I do now, and it is because of these three. And of course, my team of postdocs and PhD students over the years who are now everywhere from universities to industry, big positions in big companies, their own startups that are now doing really, really well. So it's really, I think, multiplying the effect of getting all of this out there. So, you know, without these guys, I really would not be able to stand here. Right? So I've informed you, I think. Hopefully, I don't know, I've educated you. I couldn't promise that I'll entertain you, right? But maybe...
they say, follow that. these wonderful instructions say that Eric will answer some questions. And young Bo has got some questions online, but any quick hands in the room here, in the lecture theatre? Yes, go on, George.
Go on then. So,
just look at the mic.
Sorry. Oh, sorry.
Sorry.
So, is it on?
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks. Excellent talk. Thanks very much. So, the philosopher Eric Fromm said that the search for certainty blocks the search for meaning.
The search for certainty blocks the search for meaning. Well, I guess. I'm still trying to find my meaning in life, right? You know, so maybe the more I'm doing it and getting more, the more, you know, I'm like, well, yeah, I don't quite know. You know that you know less, right? Of, you know, more and more about less and less, and that there's so much more that's out there, right? But I think certainly by me trying to find certainty in aeronautics applications, right, it's given me some sense of meaning in my life, right?
Very good. Young Bo, you've got a question
online. So first, let's ask a question that's been submitted earlier, because on the YouTube, the music just finished playing. So one question here from the audience is, many systems like our climate, we know is changing, but not necessarily know how. How should we make decisions accordingly and overcome the resistance to make changes?
Okay, right. So I guess there's a number of things there. I think certainly we've got models about climate and how things go, and we've got uncertainty models associated with that. And I think there's certainly some fundamental questions that people want asking, but they can't find the answers to. Right? And so to be able to compute those answers, or find that we need to do more maths, right? So certainly at the beginning of COVID, I think, you know, we were very much in that kind of situation where you've got these models but very little data. How do I go about doing this? And there was only so much that people could do at the time. So I think certainly we were finding that there were certain questions we were wanting to answer, but there was mathematically nothing out there, right? So the first thing is to spend research money, right, on developing new tools and methods so that we can ask more sophisticated questions and get them in a timely manner. And the other, of course, is to build models for the climate and the uncertainty associated for that are compatible, right, with a kind of tool. So the two go hand in hand, right? Was there another part of the question there?
Yeah, this is like how to overcome the resistance to make changes.
Oh, yeah. So I guess, I mean, I'm not an expert in climate change, and told Steve, who's director of the WWF, climate change, or co-director, up there. He knows much more about how to deal with this in the political issues. But certainly what we need to do, we're probably very good at working out answers for machines, and then just telling the machine, oh, do this, right? But coming up with ways in which we give this to politicians that they can understand and incorporate that in the feedback mechanism and our synthesis of the solutions is an important thing, right? So having the sort of human in the loop there and the soft touch is very challenging. I think the economists are probably also trying to solve a lot of those problems.
Yeah. Thank you.
Do we have another question in the lecture theatre? Yes, Mike.
Eric, very, you did entertain me. it was something of a shock to me to actually work with you, which was fairly early on. because I remember somewhere along the line you saying, don't get so hung up about good Kallax model. We can sort it out.
Yeah.
And I mean, quite seriously,
I think that's perfectly spot on, right? And I think the main thing there is to make a distinction for what the purpose of your model is for, right? So I think certainly a lot of the questions you want to ask the models that you're developing are suitable and appropriate to that question. When we get into the control situation, the model needs to have a different kind of fidelity and capture certain characteristics which are essential for when you're going to close the loop. And so there is really, in a way, a need to develop a model that is right for that purpose. If you've already spent a lot of time developing a model for something else, how do you get the most from that in order to get where you want to do, right? It's certainly a good question. A few years after we started, with that question in mind, Bryn Jones and I wrote a few papers on this where we could take your PDE model and discretize that PDE model and ask if it's a rubbish model, right, but can I use this for control and, you know, still guarantee something, and you can actually look control through and rigorously give an answer and say this would definitely be the right thing to do. So I think that's one way of doing it. And so it is about figuring out and incorporating that feedback as well as part of the modeling process.
Jan, would you?
Yeah. No, I need the mic, don't I?
Yes, yeah.
So I use this one?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Sorry, I'm not doing my vote of thanks yet. I'm asking a question. a little bit more technical, perhaps. When you find these scenarios that cause the violations, yeah, are you using optimization again there to find them?
Yes, yeah. So, okay. Turn it into in many cases, like a min-max, right?
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Minimization of your policy, max over the disturbance. So when you fix your policy, it then just maximizing over the disturbance. So yeah, you can either go all the way, or you just stop as soon as you've got a constraint violation. Right. Yeah.
Which is somewhat similar to what the new people were doing in robust control in the 80s,
yes,
in that concept.
Okay. Thank you.
I'm sure we've got another question online.
Yeah, we have one question online that would like to ask how non-unknowns could be beneficial in the area of business, for example, forecasting demand for new products or et cetera.
Sorry, can you repeat that again?
Yeah, so how research on known or unknowns would benefit for the area of business. So, for example, for forecasting demand for new research or et cetera.
There's certainly a whole area, right, of people in control and operations research which are looking at that, which is if you've got supply chains all the way and you're unsure about what your demand will be come Christmas time for this particular product or swimming pools and in June and July, how do you sort of plan for this, right? And so it can certainly be done, but that's really not my domain. I think in some cases you can change, you can still use the same mathematics, but what the symbols mean might be something different. Like time could maybe be an event, right, of you arriving, your ship coming in, docking, and then going on that way. And that's sort of how you can make attention to all of that. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Let's try right up at the back there. Last question.
Hi, Eric. Good to see you after so many years. It looks like you haven't aged a single bit in all these years. Amazing. I have one particular question for you. So your work has many different applications. Is there one particular one that really excites you? Thank you.
And then we don't know the atmosphere, right? We really don't know. And if you get it wrong, you know, it's a lot of billions of pounds wasted.
Go on. One more, yeah.
One
yeah.
More.
Eric, by the way, a very nice talk. You pointed out the connection with machine learning, and maybe you could say a few words more on that.
Okay. So, I certainly see control as as part of machine learning, right? Whatever that means, right? Learning, you know, it's just the word learning is about feedback. It's to try something, compare, and make corresponding changes to that, right? So if you are claiming to do any kind of machine learning, you're using feedback, and so you could be doing some control there, right? So we've been doing, I guess you could say, machine learning as the ordinary person on the street for decades, we've just not necessarily been calling it that, right? So that's one way we should do it. So for example, in proportional integral derivative control, the integral part is trying to learn, right, what offset I should put to my input in order to reject the disturbance, or equivalently, it's trying to learn what the magnitude of the disturbance is, wind gust, in order for me to make the appropriate change, say, to my airplane to counter that. Right? So you're learning either explicitly or implicitly, depending on how you formulated that problem. So I think of control as machine learning. There's a lot of people who, for them, machine learning is a very narrow definition using a very specific set of tools and techniques. And anything which is not that is not machine learning. I'm not of that opinion. I think that's all I can say for now. But there are certainly branches within machine learning where people are using tools and techniques that are unfamiliar to our community, right? And so if we're trying to work on the same problem, right? We stuck maybe trying this kind of tool or method, but they seem to be having quite a bit of success in doing this, right? So for us to learn from the other side, right, that people have never heard about control, that's also a key thing which we're always keeping our eyes on. Yeah? Okay.
Right, in deference to the audience in the theatre, I think we'll try one last question from online.
Yeah, so for one online question, how do you see optimal control in 10 years' time? What can we do that we cannot do right now?
Yeah, well, I'm hoping that we will have a car that can drive me completely autonomously from there to here, because actually we know that it can be done under very tight conditions. It's just a matter of how we change. So that would certainly be one thing. And there are people doing exactly the techniques I presented to you today. They're patenting it, they're putting it in their cars, and it will be there in 10 years' time. So that's definitely going to be a possibility. And aeroplanes as well, what we're really trying to see is far more fuel-efficient aeroplanes that are putting this in that to completely change the way they fly in terms of how things are scheduled. I know the stuff that we've worked on is maybe a little bit further down the line, which is, you know, aircraft flying in formation to reduce air drag, right? So maybe not 10 years from now, but hopefully 30 years from now, we'll see something like that, yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, Eric. I'm going to hand over to Jan Maciejowski now for the vote of thanks.
Well, thank you, Eric. Quite a tour de force there. As Eric said, I was his PhD supervisor, and I have to say, I think I had very little influence on the content of that talk we've just heard, except for one crucial academic life skill, which I think I hammered into all of my PhD students, which is 2 minutes per slide. And Eric stuck to that very accurately. Eric emphasized that his appointment is a joint one in electrical and aerospace departments, and he's been tackling problems defined by the so-called partial differential equations rather than the ordinary differential equations, which most of us like to stick to. And I suspect that from the aerospace point of view, this is a case of control is coming home. And by the way, that's the nearest I'm going to get to any other football analogies today. And what I mean by that is that when the Wright brothers first flew their plane, the problem they had to fix was one of control, because it was already been known for 10 years or more how to get the thing into the ground, off the ground into the air, but how to control it. And they sorted it out by warping the wings. So, and warping the wings is very much a partial differential equation problem. So I think in a way the thing has gone full cycle. And I suspect personally that with the advent of deformable materials, things like warpable actuators are going to be a very much bigger thing. So I think Eric's going in very much in the right direction there. So Eric has summarized very nicely several aspects of his work and how they relate to each other. He's given us his particular take on approximating these infinite dimensional problems by finite dimensional ones, very nicely. He's reminded us that the essence of control is feedback, because feedback is really the only way we have of mitigating the effects of uncertainty, that is reducing the effects. He'd shown us that real-time optimization can be used in a wide variety of feedback control problems. In fact, I think a case can be made that all control problems are actually constrained optimization problems. It's just they haven't been formulated that way until recently because we haven't had the technology to solve them in that way. And Eric has shown us, with reference to his work with George, how to use processes most efficiently to solve these kinds of tasks. Sometime during the lecture, Eric asked, doesn't everybody know about this? Or doesn't everybody need to know about this? And absolutely, I think the answer is yes. I'm sure of course, we don't have the mathematical models in fields. Well, we do to some extent with maybe climate change, less so with business, much less so with geostrategy and that kind of stuff. But I'm sure that familiarity with the concepts, if not the methods, advocated by Eric would be very useful in much wider contexts than science and engineering. And due credit to Donald Rumsfeld, of all people, who made these phrases known unknowns and unknown unknowns well known, and put his finger on a very important point. Of course, Eric so far tackled the easy bit of that, which are the known unknowns. I guess the answer to the next 10 years will be the unknown unknowns. Is that possible? Discuss, you know. But just to amplify that last point, let me finish with a couple of recent quotes to support that point. About 10 days ago, Daniel Finkelstein wrote in The Times, commenting on politicians, what he said is, we should start valuing uncertainty, doubt, pragmatism, and flexibility more. We are overcommitted to certainty. And another quote, much closer to the expertise of most of us in this room, comes from someone in the American Scientist, in Scientific American, and I couldn't identify who the person was, but they've said, where the known meets the unknown is where science begins. So, with those more or less profound reflections, let's thank Eric for a very enlightening, timely, interesting, and entertaining lecture. Thank you, Eric.